First of all, thank you all for coming along today. This is this year we have a series called Theory Meets Practice, where we try and get various elements of various practitioners to come and talk about what it's like in the real world. So we often talk from an academic perspective about issues in sport and law, and issues in music and law, and film and law. But it's really nice to see that sort of synergy, that symbiosis, where theory meets practice. Delighted to have the panellists today, the three panellists here, to talk about image rights in football. Daniel Geey, some of you may have seen before. This is the third time he's appeared in this hallowed institution. He's done sessions before for us on sports broadcasting and also on contemporary issues in sports law, both of which were fantastic and both of which are available on our YouTube channel. Never thought I'd say that, those words. But along with Daniel today, we've also got Jonny Madill, also from Sheridan's, and Pete Hackleton from Saffrey Champness. You'll see a beautifully put together joint advertising for the two companies there, for what I think is going to be a really interesting panel on image rights in football. I won't speak too much longer because I'd rather we hear from the guys themselves who are going to talk about that. At the end of this, we're going to have a chance for a Q&A, and two of the students, Harjur, I think, and... Yep, you're there? Brilliant. I'm going to be in charge of the microphone if I can get it to work, which hopefully won't be too tricky. But without further ado, I'll pass over to Daniel, Jonny and Pete to talk about image rights in football. Thank you.
All right, I will make a start. Afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming along. I'm not near the microphones. Hopefully you can all hear me. It's not usually an issue for me, I've got to say. We'll run through this presentation, and as we go through, if people have got questions on the way through, please feel free to shout them out rather than wait until the end. Happy to take them on the way through. So as it says on the slide, my name is Pete Hackleton. I'm a tax partner at Saffrey Champness. We are quite an old-fashioned, old accounting firm in many ways, 160 years old. I was at Deloitte for about 10 years, the Deloitte Sports Business Group, who some of you, I'm sure, will have come across, the Annual Review of Football Finance, Football Money League, used to be involved in all of those publications. Came across to Saffrey's about 5 years ago now to effectively set up a sports entertainment team. So 5 years on, we've got about, it says 30 on the slide, I think we're up to about 35 now in sports and entertainment. So it's a good-sized team. My main focus is sport, the sport side of sport and entertainment, and within sport, football is probably what I spend 60-70% of my time on. I'll just introduce Daniel and Jonny briefly.
Not sure whether I sit or stand, I'm going to stay here for the time being. Makes me feel even smaller compared to Pete. But I'm Daniel, this is Jonny, and we are in the sports group at Sheridan's. I think Pete is probably, if I can say, underplaying his capabilities, especially in sport. Before we go on to talk about this very briefly, is that Pete has probably worked on some of the biggest football transfers, or at least we won't be able to talk about them, specifically that there have been in the last few years, specifically with regards to a lot of image rights related work and other tax related stuff. So we feel very privileged that we've got Pete alongside us to be able to speak about specific aspects of image rights in football. And then very briefly in terms of what we do, Johnny's going to briefly touch upon a couple of the facets. So in terms of our practice, we are relatively wide in covering obviously football, which is probably what we do the most, but also in a number of other areas, including cricket, rugby, tennis, data, but specifically the commercial disputes and regulatory issues of sport. Hopefully I haven't stolen Johnny's thunder.
No worries. So I think, as Daniel and Peter touched on, image rights certainly is an area of our practice, but it's only one of a vast range of areas. And we thought we'd give you a bit of a snapshot of our practice at Sheridan's, and obviously that overlaps significantly with sort of Pete's practice. So along the right-hand side, you can see some of the typical clients, I suppose, in the sports sector that we work with on a day-to-day basis. Football would be a focus of our practice, but as Dan says, we work with clients across a number of sports. Traditionally, sports law practices probably tended to focus on working with governing bodies, clubs, maybe agents. Certainly what we found is that certainly our practice and a number of other sort of other firms, their practice would be a lot more diverse. So, you know, you take broadcasting rights in football, that's a massive area. You know, we work with sponsors, we work with brands, and then particularly sort of the final area which we're seeing a lot of activity in is sports technology, sports tech and digital sport. So whether that be social media, whether that be wearable technology, that's becoming a really big part of our practice. So I think to work in sport, as the three of us do, I think you have to have a number of strings to your bow, and you have to, you know, develop an expertise across a vast range of areas, one of which is, of course, image rights.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. And I think for me personally, certainly working in tax, I think we find ourselves quite lucky in that, you know, whatever you do, whoever you're talking to, there is always some requirement for tax advice, even if it's, you know, a company just needs their tax returns doing their accounts, and the player needs his personal tax returns, basic stuff, and we do all of that. But it's the value-added stuff that's more interesting, I think, more important for the client. Daniel, did you just want to...
Yeah, so I think what we were keen on doing is sort of just at least setting the structure and context for what we're going to talk about today. The majority, or at least a decent portion of what will be discussed actually is tax, and I promise you it's not as boring as it sounds, only because if anyone can make it interesting, Pete certainly can, although I'm sort of singing praises before you've started the process. But needless to say, the whole idea is what we're trying to do is sort of demystify what I think I considered probably until 4 or 5 years ago was quite quite an interesting area that maybe people didn't understand as much about. And sort of one of our themes, I think, that runs throughout what we're talking about this afternoon is that there is certainly now, if not an explosion, but a real trend towards at least Premier League clubs re-engaging on the image rights side of things. Now, lots of the top Premier League clubs, at least, are very much in this sphere. You may be surprised that maybe not all of the Premier League clubs across maybe the middle to bottom ranges are as engaged on these type of issues. And before we get to that stage, I think what we're hopefully going to try and do is demystify what image rights are, the landscape, and what has actually occurred in the past. Actually the process for how image rights are actually assigned and then contracted for with the different parties. Talking about a specific case that Jonny will on the Burkamp and Platt related matters, and then start thinking about a couple of issues to consider actually in a practical sense.
Okay. It's interesting, Daniel talking about that, I'll make the presentation, the tax side, quite interesting. There are two ways that that can go. It's either I can go to sports conferences and I'm talking about tax, and that's usually the session straight after lunch, you know, everybody has a nap in that one. Or I go to tax conferences and talk about sport when I'm an absolute rock star. So, so image rights. So basically, you've probably all heard of image rights. What is the image? And for a player, you think about a young player coming through, up and coming player, if they're going to enter into a boot deal or the commercial deal, the commercial party will pay the player individually. And what are they paying the player for? They're paying for the use of the player's image. Standard use of image rights back in the old days was playing in a boot or using a photo in an advertising campaign. Obviously things have moved on. So there's a definition that we use in most image rights contracts, put it up on the screen, but it's everything. It's photos of the player, signatures, so now you know, you'll have CR7 on your Cristiano Ronaldo brands, all that kind of thing. It might be the player's voice. Obviously, no image rights presentation is complete without talking about David Beckham, which we will. Hopefully with a semi-clad picture of David Beckham, that's ideal. But voice, maybe not too valuable. But it's all the personal characteristics of a player, and that's all caught within the compass of the definition of the player's image rights. So the start of the career, the player owns those rights personally.
And if I can just interject just for 1 second on a particular thing that we've seen more lately is... talking about all of those particular types of characteristics and character traits. You may have seen, for example, there's actually litigation ongoing in the US at the moment about who actually owns the right to a player's tattoo. Now, does a player's tattoo come within the player's image right? For example, if he's in FIFA, the latest FIFA game, and there is more or less a showing of that tattoo, there are these type of issues which are now cropping up for us specifically because there is an argument that says actually the ownership of that image is actually with the tattoo artist. Now, unless the player gets a waiver I'm sorry, getting into ridiculous detail here, but this is the type of stuff that actually takes up my time. Unless the player gets a waiver from the tattoo artist, effectively the player may not be able to actually say that he owns the rights to his whole body, which may actually cause problems when he is entering into endorsement deals for other types of facets.
And it'll be interesting to know what percentage of Premier League footballers have a tattoo, and it's probably very high, in which case it's a quite irrelevant, irrelevant matter.
There was a case recently as well with the gorilla that took the photo with the guy's camera, and Peter were claiming that that image belonged to the gorilla.
Yes.
And the cameraman had to defend it.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what does a player do? And the player, to a greater or lesser extent, will get heavily or not so heavily involved in image-related activities. Some players are great at this. They'll get involved in everything. They'll turn up to campaigns. They'll go on radio shows. They'll tweet actively in relation to their sponsors, and they'll use it to generate income. You know, we've looked after players in the past who happy to set up an image rights company, happy to have a boot deal, but actually they don't want to go and do an advert in London for a day for £500,000. It's a bit too much trouble. So, you know, it's about the player and how willing they are to engage. But these are all the kinds of activities that players will do in support of the kind of benefit of that image, to build that image. And then I'll cover shortly almost the bad old days of image rights. And it was interesting when Guy introduced us talking about the kind of the practice and what the theory and the practice. And I think with image rights over the last 10 years, those two have moved together. I think most clubs now in practice do implement the theory quite well, whereas in the bad old days that wasn't the case, and we would go to Premier League board meetings and talk to the clubs about how you should implement these structures, and then they'd roundly ignore it, which led to a raft of problems. But what we always used to look at was trying to convince HMRC, who would always look at an image rights structure as the starting point would be, this is a tax avoidance strategy, frankly. We always used to try and convince HMRC that the image had a value. So Gary Lineker was one that we looked at back in the day. Gary Lineker became the face of Walker's Crisps back in 95 now. The first 7 years that Gary Lineker was the face of Walker's Crisps, sales more than doubled. I mean, they're good crisps, right? I mean, you know, people buy them because they're tasty, but also Gary Lineker clearly had a positive impact. And he was paid about £1.5 million a year, so we would have argued that the benefit that he was bringing Walkers, in simple terms, was greater than the amount that they were paying him. And therefore, paying him for use of his image made commercial sense for Walkers. And that's the starting point for all the arguments on image rights. Promised you a picture of David Beckham. I mean, you know, quite simply, the best commercial proposition football's ever seen. The Real Madrid stat is one that's been repeated plenty of times. When he went to Madrid, I think it was £25 million transfer fee to Man United. It was £10 million a year package or whatever. Real Madrid reckoned that they made the cost of his transfer plus four-year deal, they made that back within 6 months of him moving to the club just on shirt sales. You know, a phenomenal commercial proposition. And I guess Beckham was almost the start of the kind of growth in the use of image over the last maybe 10 or 15 years. And this slide just looks at, from a pure tax perspective, when you are paying a player, what does it actually cost you? So this was a comparison across the top five leagues. We want to pay a player, let's say, €3 million a year net. So that's effectively €60,000 a year net. Let's call it £45,000-£50,000 a year net. What does it cost? And what you can see from this is, for English clubs, it actually costs them more than double the €3 million. And the reason for that is the top rate of tax is 45%. So players are taxed at 45% on most of their salary. So in this example, let's say the player's probably paid a salary of, call it, €5.7 million. That'll give him his €3 million after tax. The club then have to pay employer's national insurance on the salary as well, which is 13.8% on the whole lot. So to give the player €3 million in his pocket costs the club €6.4 million. The only one that's higher than that is France. Even though the French top rate of tax is lower, national insurance is much higher, so it's very expensive. And in fact, you may have read when President Hollande was looking to introduce a 75% top rate of tax,
apparently Zlatan. We don't look after Zlatan or Mino Raiola, unfortunately.
Not yet.
So Zlatan is paid something like 10 million euros a year net, and he's got a net clause in his contract. So if the 75% tax rule had come in, they'd have had to pay him 40 million euros to give him 10 million net, plus the social security on the full lot, which is like 25-30%. It would have been pretty expensive for Paris Saint-Germain. So fortunately for them, that rule didn't come in. Italy, Germany, Spain, the other three of the supposed top five leagues, all very similar in terms of top rate of tax and actually in terms of the amount it costs them. Just noted Spain on there at the bottom. Spain used to have a rule which was known as the Beckham rule, which was introduced when David moved out there, which said if you've got a non-resident player moving into Spain and doesn't intend to stay there for more than 10 years, you can just pay a flat 24% tax. So under that rule, it was obviously much, much cheaper for Spain to do that. And the reason La Liga brought that in was the worry at the time that the broadcast income for English clubs was such that mid-table English clubs would be able to outpay everybody but Real Madrid and Barcelona. Spain have a different way of distributing the broadcast income, which means that Barcelona and Real Madrid get most of it and the rest don't. So Spain had that rule, but 2010, austerity, governments around the world trying to make sure they could collect as much tax as possible, that rule was disbanded. Similar, I mean, this table is still pretty valid. This table's 3 or 4 years old, but it's still pretty much the same. The top tax rates are the same. The cost to the clubs is the same. And so what it shows is France and England, frankly, have to pay a little bit more to get the top players on the same money. But of course, the English clubs, as a rule, have huge amounts more money now as a result of the new broadcast deals. And just very briefly then, the historic position, where did all this start? It was 1995, summer 95. Image rights first started in Italy, late 80s, early 90s. Dennis Bergkamp at the time was playing at Inter Milan. David Platt had moved out and played for a few Italian clubs. And Johnny will come and talk about the case later, but this all started when Platt and Bergkamp came back to the UK summer 95. And effectively it's sent to Arsenal, we've got image rights companies, you want to use our image, you have to pay for it. As I said, by the time I moved down to London with Deloitte 2005, we were talking to the Premier League. Literally every Premier League club had some image rights contracts, some more than others. And because of, I'll just cover this slide first actually, so the benefits. So I touched on effectively the rates of tax, the fact that it costs UK clubs more to put the same net salary in the player's hand. Well, the benefit of an image rights contract is if I'm paying you, the player, £5 million a year, you're paying 45% on pretty much all of it. If instead I can say to you, the player, well, we'll pay you £4 million a year for playing football, but I'll pay you £1 million to an image rights company, then that £1 million is not salary, so it's not taxed at 45%. It's going into the player's company. Company tax rates are much, much lower. The company tax rate at the moment is 20%. It's going down to 18% in the next couple of years. So compared to paying income tax at 45%, the player also has to pay 2% national insurance. So you've got an effective 47% rate if it's paid to the player personally. You're going to be paying 18% in the company. So you're saving virtually 30% on any amount you can pay to an image rights company. That's the benefit for the individual. Why do the club want to do it? I mentioned before, the clubs have to pay national insurance on salary. A payment to an image rights company is not salary. So in my example, the £5 million, on that million pounds that you pay to the image rights company, no national insurance, 138,000 saved for one player, 25 players in the squad, year after year, you can make some big, big savings. So it was seen as a good thing by all of the clubs. There's a point at the bottom on non-UK domicile players. Some players who aren't from the UK originally can also have an offshore image rights structure, which can and does work well in certain circumstances. We may come on to that later. It depends if we've got time. But then just to go back to the historic position, because clubs realised they could make such big savings from doing this, they were falling over themselves to do it. And instead of, as I've just said, right, you're a player, I'm going to pay you £4 million to play in football, I'm going to pay you £1 million for use of your image, clubs saw, well, we can do better than that. You know, we saw some horrific examples of, there was a championship club mid-2000s who had a reserve goalkeeper who was paid 30% of his overall package as his playing contract and 70% to his image rights company. And, you know, to be fair, his own family didn't recognise him most of the time. So some of these deals were crazy. We looked after a cricketer who came to play for a county for 2 months. he was going to be paid £100,000 to play. He's from India originally. The Indian players at home don't pay tax on their cricket earnings. He said, I've got to pay tax, this is ridiculous. So he had £80,000 paid to his image rights company back in India. He earned £20,000 in the UK, he was taxed on it. Left 2 years later, the tax man came to look at it and said to the county, hey, you've paid £80,000 for this image. What benefit have you got from it? Well, we sold loads of stuff, loads of stuff in the club shop. Tell us exactly what you sold. And they sold about a dozen cups with his picture on. So you've made £30 and you've paid £80,000. Doesn't quite stack up. And the club ended up carrying the can. They had to pay all the PAYE, they had to pay all the national insurance. It cost them a fortune. So this was where HMRC really got stuck into it. Across all of the football clubs doing all of these deals. You talk to the top guys at HMRC now in Solihull, who were involved at the time, and they will say, you know, most of the guys in the office are Birmingham City fans. At one time, Birmingham had 17 players with image rights contracts, and they tried to have a quiz in the office to try and name 17 Birmingham players ever who had an image, you know, where they got stuck on Trevor Francis, I think, and Lee Carsley, probably. Just to kind of finalise where the historical position is, in 2011, HMRC offered a deal because there were all these inquiries ongoing. Clubs were taking ages, it was costing a lot of HMRC time. They said, look, let's treat a certain percentage of these image rights payments historically as salary, and you can settle the PAYE in national insurance. We'll let you off with the rest, and we'll call it a day. 19 of the clubs did that deal. But where HMRC were very clever was they didn't bring in any new legislation. They said, that's the deal, settles all your historic inquiries. If you want to do it in future, that's up to you, but just be aware we're keeping an eye on you. So that was enough to discourage a lot of clubs for a while. Interestingly, as part of the deal, that was a club deal, HMRC reserved the right also to go after the players if the player structure wasn't set up properly, which we'll also come on to later. So that's enough from me for now. Hand over to Daniel.
Thanks, Pete. So, I think the thing that, following on from what Pete is saying there, is that obviously a lot of clubs got in the most favourable sense burnt really by the deals and settlements that they had to enter into with HMRC, and I think then you can see the sort of timeline drag in effect, which then led to clubs deciding to wash their hands effectively of this type of commercial agreement with players. And that is, I think, in part the intransigence or actual reluctance for anyone apart from the bigger clubs to decide that they are going to enter into these type of agreements. But at least, again, if Pete's brought the tax side of things to life, what we were trying to do is just explain actually how in brief sense, the legalities of an image rights structure works in practice. So Johnny's going to talk about it in just a second, but at least the principle is effectively is if a player, let's say Aguero, obviously is an exceptional football player, even though he missed a few chances in the cup final at the weekend. As a Liverpool fan, it's a nightmare, so I don't want to talk about it too much. But he obviously has a very big international and global brand. Companies want to endorse him, and he obviously has inherent endorsement value. And effectively what can happen and does happen is that there is effectively an assignment of his, we say image rights, but actually we can talk about this another day, there isn't really such a thing as an image rights, image right in under UK law at least, but in terms of his endorsement right, he contractually endorses, or rather contractually assigns his endorsement rights to effectively what is usually a wholly owned image rights company. And as a result, that image rights company decides then, or rather contracts with the club and other commercial entities in order to enter into particular agreements, which Johnny will now have a good chat about.
I think I might start with this one, so I can have a look at the screen. So, so as Daniel says, what we thought it might be useful to do is actually break down the structures and actually ask the question, what are the contractual arrangements that take place between the various stakeholders? Who are the various stakeholders? Obviously the player's club, the commercial partners in an image rights company. So I suppose stage one is the player is going to contract with his club, and that's going to be the standard employment contract governing the player's employment by the club. Fairly straightforward. The player will obviously also contract with commercial partners, and probably an increasing number of commercial partners in this day and age, and probably those deals have increasing complexity as well. So that's stage one. and that's obviously the red arrow. Stage two then is, as both Pete and Daniel have talked about, is the player transferring his image right across to the image rights company by way of assignment. You've then got stage three, which I think is an interesting one, which is the image rights company is going to obviously enter into a contractual arrangement with the club and with the player's commercial partners. But I think we need to draw a key distinction here between those two arrangements. Firstly, the arrangement between the image rights company and the club is obviously going to relate to the club context, so club matters. So in other words, it's not going to cover a player's individual endorsement deal. It's going to cover club-related matters. So as an obvious example, if you take the megastore at Old Trafford, you see obviously images of players on a massive banner. That's obviously in a wider club context, not an individual context. On the other hand, when you consider the image rights company then entering into a deal with the commercial partners, that's going to relate to the individual player's own context. So it could be Gareth Bale's book deal with Adidas, as an example. So hopefully that sort of gives a bit of clarity around actually what the structures are.
And just on a final point, just and not to confuse things any further, but what you can also have is, as well as obviously the image rights, the player's image rights company contracting with the club, you can also have the player's image rights company contracting with individual commercial partners. But nowadays you actually have the vertical line whereby the club in certain instances is also buying up the player's individual endorsement capabilities, and the club is effectively acting as quasi-agent either buying those rights and then profit sharing with the player, or paying a very big premium to the player up front and then taking a bigger portion of those revenues for the commercial partners that the club finds for the player for their own endorsement deals that aren't club related.
And sorry,
no, I think it's a relatively new phenomenon, and clubs, certainly the top clubs, are getting a bit more cute about the fact that not just club rights but personal rights can be quite valuable. Yeah. And what typically happens on any deal, players sign a contract, player will sign the image rights agreement, and it will say something like the structure will be established as soon as practically possible thereafter. So you come to set up the image rights company itself, Daniel will review the contracts and will say, well, yeah, the club have now secured all these personal rights, we think we should carve those rights out. And in, you know, depending on how high profile the player, the club might say, you've signed the contract, it's too late. If it's a player they don't want to upset, they might say, actually, let's have a discussion about it.
And perhaps I'm trying to think of a good practical example of that sort of vertical arrangement. I think Liverpool and Nivea have a deal now, and that's probably a good example where, I don't know, four or five players feature in the advert.
There was a Chelsea and Budweiser one before the World Cup for three players, and I think that Joe Hart Head and Shoulders was Head and Shoulders approach Man City rather than Hart. So.
Yeah. Okay, moving on to these two gentlemen. I'm not sure if there are any Arsenal fans in the room, probably still trying to recover from last night, but so why is this significant? So if we cast our minds back to summer of 1995, Arsenal decided to sign Dennis Bergkamp from Inter Milan, as Pete said earlier on, and David Platt from, let me throw this one to the floor, anybody know who Arsenal signed? Very good, I'm sure it'll be a prize of some sort at the end. Okay, so the players signed for Arsenal. Both players had existing image rights companies in place. So let's, you know, think of the context. We're talking 1995 here. We're still very, very early on in the sort of image rights process. Bergkamp's, I think, had been in place since about 1991. So his third-party image rights company, I think, sub-licensed to an intermediary company owned by his agent, actually, which in turn sub-licensed to both his club and also Reebok for his individual deal. Platt, on the other hand, he did have an offshore image rights company, but he then wound that up, and then when he signed for Arsenal, he set up a UK-based image rights company, and I think him and his wife were sole shareholders and directors. So both players signed for the club. Thinking back to our contractual arrangements, Arsenal obviously entered into a playing contract with both Platt and Bergkamp. And they also entered into an image rights contract with the two respective image rights companies. So obviously Arsenal paid a fee to both companies in return for the right to exploit Platt's image right, Berkham's image right, and also for Platt and Berkham to provide some form of promotional services to assist with the exploitation of the image rights. So all very straightforward, nothing strange or startling. However, the UK tax authorities decided that they were going to investigate the general structures and the contractual arrangements. And if I'm right, and I'm sure people correct me, it was initially Inland Revenue and then HMRC, obviously, that brought the investigation. And it ended up going to a tribunal hearing. And I think why this is particularly significant, obviously, whilst there have been other disputes between HMRC and clubs, I think this is the only one to date that has ended up in a judgment being given.
Yeah.
Which is why it's obviously particularly interesting. So I thought it would be useful to have a look at what were the key arguments from HMRC and what were the key arguments from the club and the players. So, effectively, what was HMRC saying? It was saying that the payments by Arsenal under the image rights contracts to the image rights companies constituted payments from the players' employment contracts. And they said that these payments to the image rights companies from Arsenal were inextricably linked to the players' employment as footballers by Arsenal Football Club. And they were not, therefore, genuine commercial transactions. And I should have said in the first point that basically these payments should be subject to normal deductions under income tax. That was a big argument. And this term was used, and in the third point there, smokescreen or window dressing, that's what it was described as. And basically they said that these payments were structured and presented as payments under an image rights deal, but with the sole purpose of circumventing Arsenal's wage structure. So that was sort of, broadly speaking, what the main arguments were. The club and the players appealed, and they basically said, now hold on a minute here, the exploitation of the image rights by Arsenal, the value is entirely independent from the playing services under the playing contract. And basically the services provided to the club under an image rights contract would typically go way beyond what is expected of a player under the standard Premier League contract. And Daniel will talk in a few minutes time about actually what the Premier League standard contract says or doesn't say. So those were the sort of conflicting arguments. In the end, the club and players were successful, the taxpayers were successful, and its sports club case has remained a very significant judgment ever since. And that was the decision. I'm not sure if Pete has any sort of nuggets that he'd like to pick out from the...
No, it's just reiterating what you were saying, John. It's that final sentence that we've underlined, which is a key one. The judge said that it was not right to describe the payments as a smokescreen for additional remuneration. It wasn't the club trying to pay wages by another means. Payments were to be made under them, the image rights contracts, and the image rights companies, could have been sued upon them. So, as with the typical image rights structure, the players, as part of assigning the rights into the company, they also sign an agreement which states that they will carry out activities to service those rights. You know, if sponsors had demanded that, you know, David Platt plays in such and such a boot, or Dennis Bergkamp has to come and open such and such a supermarket, that's what they would have had to do. And if they didn't do it, the image rights companies could have been sued. So they were genuine bona fide arrangements, and as a result HMRC couldn't treat them as a smokescreen and just look through them.
So hopefully that leads on nicely now to Daniel, who's going to talk about actually what does the standard form player contract look like.
Thanks, Johnny. I'm going to keep sitting. So, just by way of context, it's actually in the public domain in the Premier League handbook, the actual pro forma standard form player contract. So anybody can go online and find the actual player contract, Premier League playing contract. And clause 4.6, and I don't really like reading out too much particular parts, but it's important just to sort of demarcate specifically, at least at the basic level, about why image rights contracts are sometimes important, especially from a club perspective. And the reason why is because 4.6 says
player grants the club the right to photograph the player and to use such photographs and the player's image in a club context.
And this is what Jonny was talking about previously, Peter's chatted about, and I've discussed just prior to that, which is, in a way, almost if you can think that the player has effectively obligations to the club to be able to not necessarily promote and endorse, but use their image to be used in a club program of commercial within its commercial program strategy. So, whereas it can sometimes be the case that in a club context, at least. Let's just say Harry Kane in his Tottenham kit may be plastered over the Spurs club shop. There are certain limits to that capability for the club to use those images in certain instances. And that's where the restrictions on the FAPL contract come in. So the first one is probably, I think, one of the most important ones, as well as obviously the last, but it specifically states that the club's use of the player's image must not be greater than the average for all first team players. The point about that obviously is that there are a number of players in the top teams and even middle teams that commercial partners will want to use their image for. So Harry Kane, Aguero, trying to think of a Liverpool player who would actually be of significant use at the moment, but Wayne Rooney and others, for example. All of those type of players, obviously commercial partners will find real value attached to them. And under the standard playing contract, and this is more or less the point, the club won't be able to use its star players all the time because, as the playing as the standard playing contract says, they can't be used, the image can't be used more than a greater than the average for all first team players. So what effectively happens in practice is that there is an image rights contract which is also entered into, which gives the club the additional benefit control use of the player to be able to be used for club context promotional opportunities. And that's effectively what clause 4.11 says right at the bottom. I'm sorry for everyone getting it everyone's way. It more or less just gives the ability of the club and the player to enter into additional agreements over and above what the standard template form is. So if I then can turn to the next point, which is I think probably one of the most significant image rights contracts that get into entered into, unless any Peter suggests otherwise. I almost think that's the most complicated agreement that I always see between club and image rights company. Again, by giving just a small bit of context, usually what is happening here is that an image rights company can be contracting with the club. Usually, it can happen at the same time as a commercial, as an employment contract renegotiation, or what can happen a lot of the time is that when a player is transferring, maybe from abroad to a Premier League club, or from a smaller Championship club to a Premier League club who has a higher higher popularity, greater visibility in the endorsement space, that image rights agreements will be negotiated at the same time as the employment contract and effectively at the same time as the transfer agreement that is actually being undertaken. So when everyone effectively says, oh, well, surely it's just a pretty easy thing to get a transfer over the line, we're seeing now, especially when we're talking about big superstars that have significant endorsement value, a large portion of the negotiation, and I know I remember from Pete mentioning, without saying particular names, that a lot of the time now, a lot of that negotiation actually comes down to image rights issues as well as employment, remuneration, particular performance clauses and other types of issues. So an image rights deal is right in the heart of the transfer agreement, than rather the complete transfer that can take place. And when we've talked previously about club context and basically club capacity, what we're really saying is that this contract between the image rights company and the club effectively gives the club additional rights or endorsement rights, subject to a fee, obviously, and quite a substantive fee a lot of the time, to be able to do a number of things, to be able to use the player's image, to be able to require a certain amount of personal appearances, and obviously because of new media, digital, a lot of the top clubs having either websites and or club channels, the need to create content, and that being an important part of you know, interviewing star players, doing particular programs that would involve the players and to get their player buy-in. All of that is to be able to gain an additional amount of effective control that the club can have over the player to ensure that all of their partners and the commercial partners are satisfied with the types of endorsement deals that they're entering into. Now, the thing that can obviously get a little bit tricky is sometimes, and this is where again the control can happen from a negative perspective, is that sometimes under the image rights agreement between the company and the club, is that sometimes they will ensure that actually players can't enter into endorsement deals for particular types of brands. So it may actually be a reputation thing that some clubs, for example, won't want their players to be entering into betting, gambling, alcohol related deals with particular companies. It may also be that they have a stadium or a main club tiered brand, like for example, let's just say Arsenal with the Emirates. I think it's pretty clear that really Arsenal won't want its players being endorsed by a competing airline brand to the Emirates, for obvious reasons that it devalues the Emirates brand. The Emirates have paid Arsenal a lot of money for, so there is a controlling element effectively in that.
Yeah, and it's, you know, there are always going to be competing forces there, and that's where Daniel and Jonny will get involved in making sure that the rights are carved out appropriately. So just off the top of my head, thinking about you know, you got James Milner playing in the Barclays Premier League, Liverpool sponsored by Standard Chartered, England not anymore but were sponsored by Nationwide, and so already you can see, you know, you've got three different banks there who might all have a claim over James Milner in a different capacity, and it's about making sure that in the contracts that the various rights are carved out appropriately.
Exactly, and I think the other interesting that I find is where sometimes where all of those things align quite nicely. So when you were talking about James having different potential conflicts in the other way, brands, especially footwear brands, because footwear effectively and gloves are the only things that are usually carved out of the restrictions, is that you will always see, so if you give the two most blatant examples, you have Cristiano Ronaldo, who is Real Madrid and Adidas, wearing Nike boots, and you have Lionel Messi, who is Nike Barcelona but wearing Adidas boots. Brands especially are looking for that almost synergy between club boot and national team, whereas my view, at least from other people I've heard, is that when Gareth Bale, for example, signed for Real Madrid, obviously Bale is Adidas, Real Madrid being Adidas as well, Adidas made a real play to get the Welsh national team, because all of a sudden Bale becomes a completely rounded Adidas endorsed athlete, and that gets round, or makes sometimes more easily, the types of issues and restrictions that can sometimes come to play with these type of image rights endorsement deals. And then lastly, when we talk about individual endorsement, then these are obviously deals like a boot deal or a glove deal for goalkeepers, or different lifestyle brands, telecommunications, other types of, you know, gaming or interactive brands that a lot of some of my clients are getting involved in these days, whereby the club does not have any say. I say the club is not directly involved in the actual contractual relationship. It is simply between the club, between the player's image rights company and the actual endorsement brand itself. Where things get a little bit trickier, where we're talking about before, is sometimes the club will take more of those rights and will then act as the agent effectively, which means that a player sometimes, and some of the top players, actually won't have that much individual endorsement capability. And sometimes that's of advantage to the agent, because the agent is thinking, I just want to get the best employment deal, i.e. the best contractual employment deal for the player. I don't necessarily have the time to be able to looking after five or six different brands, negotiating with them on particular territories. If there is someone there that can do that already and we take a profit share of that, then that can also be pretty handy. So, I'm not sure if it's me next, I think.
Pete?
Just in terms of implementing these, which I'll stand up again and give myself some exercise. So just in terms of implementing these properly, I think, again, back in the bad old days, mid-2000s, clubs would just go entering into these contracts willy-nilly.
But I think it was important to make sure that things were done properly and clubs had clear guidance on how they should be doing things. So we talked to all the clubs about the fact that you're going to be entering into some pretty serious commercial contracts. They're going to have some significant value and you're going to be paying a lot of money. So if you were entering into a contract for anything else, you'd have thought about this at board level and you'd have some documentation and some parameters and some thought process to behind how you enter into these decisions. It was making sure the players had the image rights company set up properly. Again, back in mid-2000s, clubs just didn't even check this. And so HMRC would come to look at an inquiry, and even with a sports club case in mind, and they'd be aware that if the rights are in the company, then payments to the company, they're probably going to struggle to challenge. So they'd say, right, give us the evidence that the rights have actually been transferred to the company. Where's the assignment document? Never been done. Player just set up a company and started invoicing the club. So that was an important part. And then along the lines of the point that we've all mentioned, this shouldn't be, right, the total contract's going to be $5 million a year, let's call it $4 million for playing and $1 million for the image. That was never the way it should be, because it's two separate agreements. It's what is the value of the employment contract and what is the value of the player's image. Now, it's probably logical that the sum of those two equals the total package that the club are willing to offer, but there's got to be some science about how you decide that. So once you've agreed to contract to use the image, you should have a plan for how you're going to use it, which commercial campaigns you want to use it in. Let me just go back to this slide. Just Daniel made the point that the club's use of the player's image must not be greater than the average of all first team players. You know, the Premier League has developed now, you know, out of all recognition from where it was when it started back in 92. I think Manchester United now have something like 78 commercial partners. 78 commercial partners is a lot of partners who want to use an image of probably Wayne Rooney, Memphis, maybe not Michael Carrick, all you know, deference to Michael Carrick, great player. So the clubs, it's important for them to be able to secure the players' individual rights and then provide the players that they always wanted to use. If I go back to saying, you know, and we'll talk about what's the right proportion of an overall package that should sit in an image rights company, because HMRC always come at it from that perspective. They have a view of what the maximum amount of an overall package should be paid as an image rights payment. The example I always used to talk about on this was Park Ji-sung at Man United. Park, very good player for United for a long time, not one of their top earners, reputed to be on about 50,000 or 60,000 a week. But Park's commercial value to Manchester United, to me, was more than 20% of 50k a week. It was more than $500,000 a year. I mean, the campaigns they used to use Park, you know, Kumho Tires, DHL in Asia, all of those brands wanted to use Park as one of the, usually you get three players in a campaign. They all demanded Park as one of those players. So I think there are certainly examples where the commercial value is as great, if not greater, than the playing value. In the main, HMRC are probably right. Playing value should be greater, significantly greater, but the image does still have a value. The split between UK and non-UK rights, again, I alluded to it earlier. For the purposes of this discussion, I'll probably just say that where you've got players who move into the UK, if they were to set up, instead of just a UK company, taxed at 20%, which is reduced into 18%, if they had to set up a company in Guernsey or Jersey or another jurisdiction which has a 0% tax rate, they don't pay any tax on the company profits. But HMRC have clearly had a look at that. You've got to be able to justify the value of the non-UK rights, and you've got to be able to clearly demonstrate that. So in that situation where you've got a big club, player transfers rights into both a UK and a non-UK company, the club will contract with both companies, and they'll contract with the UK company for UK rights and the non-UK company for rest of the world rights. But you've got to be clear that that contract just relates to activities outside of the UK and use of image outside of the UK, and you've got to be able to justify that split. And then it was making sure back in the day that all this was properly documented. Of course, you speak to a club in February, they've done five deals on transfer deadline day, and you said, did you do any image rights deals on any of those? Oh yeah, we did it on all of them. Okay, so you had those separate discussions and you documented what was said and you got all that on the, we'll get around to it. And they never did. And the final point, which we always said was key, and we did help a few clubs with this,
monitoring the activity afterwards. Again, the top clubs now are very good at this. You ask them, right, list of campaigns, who was in each one, they can provide that in no time. The mid to lower Premier League clubs, they don't have 78 commercial partners, they might have 15, but it might still take them a while to work out who did what over the course of the year. So that's something that the clubs are certainly developing at the moment.
Yeah. So I think, at least at a basic level, when you're talking almost about the audit trail, I think the important thing just to stress is that this is almost where the lawyers, if they don't add value before, which hopefully we do, we certainly continue to add value, because in my experience of dealing with the assignment documentation, you're doing everything to do with the valuation piece originally, and then also what can turn into a pretty hefty document for the image rights company negotiating with the club. We were doing one relatively recently which went into over 25 pages, which I say is surprising, but actually the benefit of such a deeply negotiated document is it becomes a much easier exercise, at least if you can put all of those pieces together with the assignment documentation, email correspondence about the valuation, the actual valuation itself, the negotiation that happened with the club, what rights are actually being included, what is being excluded, what is club context, what are the types of restrictive agreements that aren't, brands that aren't going to be included. All of this provides, and that's not including the other endorsement deals, all this provides a pretty robust audit trail in order to get you to where you want to get to, especially with everything that has gone before. So just as Pete was mentioning, to do with everything that's happened back in, and Jonny, back in the 2000 or 2000 era, I think in a way the message that I'm trying to get across to a number of clubs, but also actually to a number of agents and players, is I still think a number of agents are of the view that this is quite a risky process, and to some it may well be, and Pete will talk about in the next slide about actually what the Premier League is engaged with HMRC on a number of levels in order to come up with some type of comfort and stability in terms of image rights work. But I think that the thing that I always stress, that we've worked together on some matters, is the agents are always absolutely flabbergasted with the savings that can come for specifically the player, but also the club. So sometimes they say, well, why on earth would the club agree to do this? And just as you mentioned, there's, you know, a 13.8% NI saving. And also on the player's side, you're not obviously being taxed at 45%, you're being taxed at corporation tax at 20. But there's also another advantage to that, which is you may just decide to do nothing with that money. You may decide at 20 years old that your image rights company is just going to keep on hopefully gradually building up a great pot. You forget about it, and then at 34 years old, you've got a fantastic pot that you can decide actually what to do with. The other side of all of that is an image rights deal suddenly becomes, an image rights company becomes efficient for a number of other reasons. We've had instances over the last few years where players are basically paying members of their family out of their net salary, whereas if the family are actually providing services to the player, whatever it may be, they can effectively be employees of the image rights company and therefore can be effectively a taxable deduction. So there's much more efficient ways of doing certain processes that that we've seen. And I guess on the second to last, third to last point about quantifying commercial worth, obviously, and it's a point that you're going to mention also in terms of the split. There's obviously still, and you mentioned the one size doesn't fit all approach. There's obviously going to be those footballers whose image is worth almost as much value to the team as their performance on the pitch, at least from a commercial aspect. And those are the types of agreements where you may get over a certain percentage amount, just like we were talking about with Park, for example. Yeah. And I think that's very important to consider, is that the flip side is sometimes we see 17-year-olds that say, I want an image rights deal. And the question with all of that is, well, what's your value? Mm-hmm. What's the value of your image? It may be that you are not quite playing in the Premier League. It may be that soon you will have that value. So it's, again, that not one size fits all approach. Sometimes it can be an established Premier League player who is captain of their team that may be going into the international sphere, maybe playing in World Cups. There's obviously an endorsement value attached to that. Flip side is up-and-coming players who may think that they deserve an image rights deal because it's a nice way of getting paid extra. The very point that Pete made, which is actually all of this isn't a way to get around paying tax. This is a way to be efficient with how your endorsement value is actually monetized. Yeah. And I think that's probably the point.
I probably haven't covered in enough detail. We mentioned at the start where you've got a young player coming through. The player owns his own rights. It's all about him. What you've got to get to the image rights company, the step is you've got to transfer the rights, and those rights must have a value. Otherwise, why would you be transferring them? And it's been, you know, the classic, you know, ask five accountants, get five different answers for a few years, but we're quite clear on this. The player transfers his image. You can value that image. You do a discounted cash flow analysis, net present value analysis on the likely endorsement income over the next few years. You get to a value. The company has to pay the player for those rights. You wouldn't necessarily do it up front. Let's say we value those rights at £100,000. The rights transfer to the company. The company then owes the player personally £100,000, which it will pay over time as it generates income. The player's made a disposal for tax purposes, and the player should pay capital gains tax on that disposal. There are a couple of capital gains tax reliefs, without getting too technical, that you can use to try and defer or prevent yourself from paying capital gains tax. To qualify for those reliefs, you have to be transferring an existing trade. And just because you've got a player with a boot deal, that doesn't mean he's trading with the image. It's quite rare that you can manage to defer that gain. So our advice generally, other than the odd exception, is you value the image, you transfer it, and you pay the tax on that transfer. And if you've got a young player, value £100,000, let's say they end up paying about £25,000 of capital gains tax, in 5 or 6 years when HMRC come knocking and the image rights company's earning, you know, £1.5 million a year, and they say, well, did you assign those rights and, you know, did you pay any tax at the time? You said, yeah, we did. Well, there's a valuation document, there's a tax return and the tax that was paid. And by the way, you didn't challenge it back then. So have you got any more questions? And generally the answer is no. If you haven't done that step and HMRC come knocking and they're saying, this is an asset that's generated £1.5 million a year, therefore, even 5 or 6 years ago, we think it was worth £2 million. Please can I have my tax? That's a different story. It's really important to get that first step done properly. Current position, and we focus a lot, I think, today, and obviously I focus on tax. I love tax. I focus on it quite heavily. And that was always the rationale for an image rights structure, frankly, back in the 90s, save some tax. I think now, and even HMRC agree with me, and I know this for a fact because I took them to speak to a club, HMRC recognise now, going back to the slide Daniel ran through, standard Premier League contract, the commercial value of the Premier League. You know, the broadcast income is almost out of the club's control, it's centrally negotiated. Match day, Premier League clubs have 97% attendance. We've all seen what happens when Liverpool try and put the prices up recently. I mean, Arsenal fans, they don't mind, but Liverpool fans are not having it. So there's a limit.
What do Barnsley charge these days?
Barnsley, it's expensive. Expensive. It's £45 for me plus a six-year-old. So, yeah, expensive. My big club, though. There's a limit to where you can go with match day. Commercial is where the potential growth is across the world. And so HMRC recognise that it is important for the clubs to have access to the players over and above the standard Premier League contract. And if the players have their rights in an image rights company, the club have to pay for it. That's the reality. And I went to one Premier League club about a year and a half ago. We were doing a deal on deadline day. The agent said, right, the player wants £45,000 a week after tax. He's been in England before. He's got a UK company. He's got a non-UK company. So you, the club, pay him £60,000 a week salary plus £6,000 to each of his image rights companies. £72,000 it costs the club. Player gets £45,000. The club went away and thought about it, came back in and said, we'll give him the 45, we don't like image rights, we're not sure, so we'll just pay salary, 80,000 a week. So it's cost them 8,000 a week, 400,000 a year, costs 125,000 in national insurance, over £500,000 for one player for 1 year because they wouldn't do image rights. Still uncomfortable with it. I brought HMRC down to speak to them. They said, you know, do you do image? Oh, no, we don't do image rights. They said, well, you probably should be. You're at a disadvantage with lots of similar clubs who do image rights because they're saving lots of money. And we recognise now the commercial value of those rights and that you should be paying for it. Interesting, the clubs still don't do image rights.
Sorry, Pete, ask you a question. So clubs in sort of the lower leagues, League One, League
yeah,
Two,
yeah.
Are attitudes changing, or is it still an ongoing process from your experience? Because I know we maybe have a slightly different perspective.
League One or Two, typically they don't get involved. Championship clubs now, there are a few who do it quite regularly. Premier League clubs as a whole, over half, the top three or four probably do it as standard. Mm. Most of the rest will do it for the right players, but there are still, I would say, four or five clubs who just say, we still don't believe in it, we're not doing it. What's changed is that exactly a year ago, just over a year ago, February 2015, HMRC agreed some parameters with the club. So this was negotiated by the top six clubs, rolled out to the rest, and it's a three-year deal. HMRC have said, as long as you make image rights payments within certain caps, we won't challenge you, the club. We can still go after the player if it's not set up properly, but you, the club, are safe. And those caps, the tier one cap is a player cap, and that's 20% of the player's salary. That's the caps that you pay to the image rights company. That's not 20% as in we're going to pay you 5 million a year, so a million of it is image rights. It's we're paying you a salary of 4 million a year. The maximum you can pay to the image rights company is 20% of that, so 800k in that example. So that's the cap for the club, for the player. The tier two cap, the club cap, is around the club's commercial income. So the club can make total image rights payments of 15% of its commercial income. So Chelsea last year had 80 million of commercial income. They can make payments of 12 million. Across all of their image rights companies. How they cut it is up to them. So a lot of the clubs have signed up to this, some haven't. All the clubs have to do if they sign up to it is submit one return each year to say, these are the image rights companies, these are the amounts paid. HMRC expect the players have done a minimum of three appearances, as long as they've got that, no problems. There's an exceptional player clause. If you believe that the player has exceptional commercial value, you can write to HMRC to get pre-agreement to pay more than 20% to an image rights company. One club have already applied, one club have been turned down. The reason they applied was they wanted to sign up to the deal, but they had an existing image rights contract in place that was worth 26% of salary. So they tried to apply as an exceptional player. And I could see why they did it, famous in his country. The club were considering pre-season tours there, there was clear value, but HMRC weren't wearing it. They see that exceptional player clause as being Ronaldo, Messi, Neymar. So still absolutely crucial that the players get that initial setup part right. Interestingly, like I said, just over half the clubs have signed up. We did a deal in January. The club were happy to enter into an image rights agreement. And we said, have you signed up to the HMRC agreement? They said, oh no, we're not signing up to that. Why not? We think it's just HMRC keeping an eye on us. So there's always that kind of attitude of mistrust. Like I said, we know that the guys who run this unit of HMRC, they've been doing it for 20 years. They would be just happy if a club would sign up and they don't have to spend any more time investigating all this. They feel like these two caps mean it brings it all under control. There's a limit to how much the clubs can get away with. So we'll see if more sign up over time.
Yeah, so just by way of summary, just by way of a quick story before we get into any questions. One of the first points you said is commercially astute players, agents and clubs should at least be talking about these structures. By way of example, over the summer there was a pretty established Premier League player who renegotiated his contract for a substantive raise, and the agent really considered that, believed that actually the player didn't have an image right to be able to actually endorse, even though he'd been playing in the Premier League for probably four seasons, pretty established player, vice captain of the team, and the player had no idea that actually this was a possibility. So the moral of the story is, you've got a forward-thinking agent that may be risk-averse, that's absolutely fine. That player, when we did the calculation to him, or rather for the agent, the player would have saved about £180,000 per season after all of the costs of putting the IR company in place. I'm not convinced the agents and the player were particularly happy with each other after we we gave them the analysis, but that's for another day. So the idea really is, I think we're saying obviously not one size or one size doesn't fit all, but I think really my at least quite bullish view is that any Premier League player that has been playing in the Premier League for a number of years, more or less based on the global appeal of the league, can and probably can justify an endorsement valuation. It may not be up to that 20% limit, but at the same time, it may still be a worthwhile enough sum for it to be worthwhile for the club and also for the player. And I think the other point also is that, you know, regardless if it's us or another law firm, an accounting firm do it, it's absolutely vital that the club player agent is actually documenting and making sure that the process is working efficiently and correctly, because, you know, we've seen plenty of examples where, you know, a few missing documents can make a real big problem for the clubs. And the sort of the lesson for some of this is that clubs, regardless of what you say to them, just as Peter was saying, are just very risk averse and at the moment aren't necessarily going to be taking this on board. But bearing in mind, if the average Premier League player is earning maybe £1.5 to 2 million, an individual saving to the club of each player can be almost £200,000. You multiply £200,000 across your, let's say, even 10 members of your playing squad, and there's really significant savings that a club can make even in 1 year's worth of 1 year's of entering into these agreements. So just from a practical perspective, not necessary to flog our own services to the same degree, it should be pretty useful and should be pretty cost effective. Anything else?
I think that's right. I think your example's spot on. I mean, if you've got just, you know, 10 players and you're saving £200,000 a year on each one, it's £2 million a year, that's an extra player, isn't it?
Yeah.
£40,000 a week.
So, yeah. So on that £40,000 a week note.
Well, what can I say? First of all, I thought that was fantastic. Daniel said at the beginning that he was going to try and demystify the process, and I think that it was all three of you very clear, very concise, a really good run through, and bringing the tax element in was fascinating. You know, we talk about theory meets practice and using law and practitioners, but to look at other areas of professional practice and how that impacts upon it as well, yeah, was a really nice addition to that. For the Q&A, we've got two student helpers who's going to carry this microphone around for us. Do you want to come and grab the microphone? So you can pass it around for all these many questions. Come on. You'll get a special mention to your personal tutor when I'm writing references for you. Yeah, don't worry. When you're applying for jobs at these guys.
Yeah, you're making an assumption, guy, that actually anyone's got a question to ask.
Well, hopefully. I've got to think of one now. In terms of the questions, we've got a mixture here of students, both on the LLM, on the LLB, medicine RPCs as well, but also a number of external guests here as well. So if you could just say your name, it could just be your name, and say where you're from, LLB students or wherever you're from, that'd be really handy before you give us the question. So put your hand up and then one of you two will go around. So, first question, anyone? I know it was very, very precise what the guys have done, but there surely is some question. Yeah, thank you.
I've got a vested interest in the question because I'm related to one of the speakers.
Hi, Dad.
The standard form of contract for Premier League players, I think it's Rule 4, yeah. Clause 4, whatever it may be called, is interesting. If one takes a club such as West Bromwich Albion, for example, which may be said without being disrespectful to any of the players, to have one standout player, Berahima, how does that club go about measuring his worth in terms of endorsements by reference to the average worth of the rest of the team?
I think historically, it was more important because now that we've got the standard HMRC agreement, as long as you're within the caps, HMRC don't care. But going back to just before 2015, what the club would do, we would always work with clubs. So we did this for a manager, interestingly, with a Premier League club. Manager was quite charismatic and high profile. And we went through a process of looking at their existing endorsement deals and whether we thought there'd be any added value of using the manager in any of these campaigns. And in a couple, there were clauses that said if any of the players or management do extra things, we might pay the club more money. But we also looked at whether we thought the club would generate new commercial opportunities as a
by virtue of using that manager. And where we got to was we reckoned that the club could generate an additional between £400,000 and £500,000, and we justified £250,000 a year payment to his image rights company. That's where we got to. I think in your example, I think what West Brom might do, again, is look at Berahino, look at whether he would generate significant commercial opportunities for them, and then looking at existing contracts, would they be able to generate any additional performance clauses just by using him? It was always a difficult one, because that was always something HMRC would ask about, how do you justify this payment? And it almost felt like an artificial process, because you were having to try and justify that additional value, whereas actually the endorsers want to work with a club, but then primarily they want to work with a club because they want to work with player X, Y and Z, and that's
right, so the cap would include any vertical agreement.
Exactly, yes.
And then a lot of the time you could be quite forensic in actually find out from, and it's usually with the bigger clubs, actually who the commercial partners want specifically explicitly set out in their agreement. They say, like you were saying, for Park, it may well be that you can actually in some way demonstrate that 20% of foreign endorsement contracts required this player or this player as part of that process. Yeah.
Thanks very much for the presentation. The question is going to be around the foreign players again, to justify really. I mean, you quoted the example of, you gave the example of Park earlier, where you said that obviously the value of commercially these image rights with massive companies in Asia is obviously significant more, significantly more than potentially 20% of the overall employment contract value. What are the means for players like this in similar situations to be able to justify potentially a much higher image right valuation when they're not superstars yet, but clearly the market overseas represents such a value, whether that's in Asia or other emerging markets?
It's an argument I would have loved to have had on Park, because I think there was an example where, as Daniel just referred to, you know, certain brands were insistent they used him, and therefore you could probably argue that you either wouldn't have won the contract or it would have been a reduced contract without him. You could probably put a compelling argument together for X amount of income directly related to the use of his image, and therefore if you're paying him Y and it's less than X, why wouldn't you do it as a company? In terms of new players coming through, I think the new deal with HMRC is helpful from that perspective, because you've got the exceptional player clause. So if you had a player coming through who wasn't yet a big name but was already attractive to various entities commercially, I think you could put a submission together to HMRC to make that case. I don't think it's going to be viewed sympathetically to start with, because in their minds, as I said, it's a Beckham, Ronaldo, Messi type rule. But I think if you can put the argument together to demonstrate the player's value over and above the playing rights, it's something they're going to have to start considering. And I know the first submission I mentioned, the club had already tried it and been knocked back. In all fairness, the player wasn't the most compelling case ever. I could see other cases being made, and I think it's an interesting one, and one that hopefully we'll be able to get involved in at some point.
Which I had it, well, I've sort of got two questions. The first one sort of bridges off of the Park debate as well. With commercial partners able to specifically request individual players or a select group of players, does this ever cause problems for other players who then feel that they're being restricted in a sense, like not being able to gain further commercial opportunities because they're not being requested as much because of that market in particular? Does it then cause friction or any further issues?
Well, my view on that, in theory, possibly, but in my experience, players perhaps aren't as keen to crack on with lots of different commercial partners all the time. So usually, especially for the top players who are on extremely good money anyway, there may be commercial obligations that they have to adhere to. To say that some of them are less than enamoured about
necessarily doing it all of the time would probably be fair. So there's obviously always that balance between, you know, the main guys who are making significant money from the endorsement deals, fair enough. I think sometimes the pressure would come from the player telling their own agent that why is so-and-so managing to get the big brand deal, or why is X and Y flying across the world to do particular things. I'm of that same type of level, sort of the Jerry Maguire type of process back in the day. That was sort of my initial view.
I think that's right. I mean, I think the players just, if the image rights company is getting paid by the club, they're not too bothered about how much it's been used generally. I know United used to have Thursday mornings, I think it was, that was more the commercial part of the day, and lots of the partners would come in and do shit, and the players would be sat waiting to go and do various things. And if they weren't doing it, they were having a chat and playing pool or whatever, they didn't mind. So, yeah.
Thanks. And the second question relates to the standard form contract, which we saw. One of the restrictions was that they can't promote services or brands which compete with or conflict with their club or the league's two main sponsors. But as I'm sure you guys know, next season the Premier League is removing its sponsor. So is that going to open floodgates almost for, why not at the moment it's only really banks, but is that going to change a lot of things, or is that going to have a big effect on the contracts themselves?
So it may have actually an impact more sometimes on the clubs, because there's obviously the same restriction for the clubs not being able to enter into particular types of commercial agreements with financial institutions, for example, and that will change. I'm not sure if the Premier League have announced all of their tiered sponsors for next year, but in any event, I think probably, it's actually a really good question. I'm not actually sure the answer, because the player restrictions will usually be from the template, but also from the club. So the player will know the club restrictions that it can't necessarily enter into. Those restrictions in the Premier League contract may also be translated into the actual club contract as well. So at least they will know up until probably the end of this season what they can and can't enter into. I'd have thought there might be some additional mechanism that may actually occur with the Premier League template from next season. I'm not sure if you know.
I presume any new title sponsor coming in would be able to place restrictions on players and clubs, but only on any new agreements going forward. So
I'd have thought so.
So, yeah.
But I think there isn't going to be any more title sponsor for the Premier League. So I think it's just going to be like four or five tiered. Okay. And if that's the case, I'm not convinced each one of them would have the capability to be able to put the same type of restrictions that obviously Barclays has already been able to do.
We've actually seen the same issues apply in a different sporting context. So we would do a lot of work in esports, electronic sports, gaming sports essentially, and we're actually working with a new league to set up a set of commercial regulations. And obviously we were talking about this morning, thinking about what restrictions we're going to have to put on the teams and on the players of those teams in relation to their own arrangements with third party sponsors and commercial arrangements. Ultimately the league will need to make sure that its commercial arrangements are in place before you can put in place any restrictions. So was that partly answers your question around what the Premier League needs to do?
Thanks for that talk. It's really, really interesting. So just in context, I work in a sports sponsorship and commercial agency, so we deal with a lot of sponsorship contracts, and it's quite interesting. So a lot of what you discussed is reflected in how these arrangements are being kind of formulated. So on the Emirates point, was really interesting, because Barcelona, for instance, are looking to replace Qatar Airways as their title sponsor for a number of reasons. The new proposal that they are putting out into the market includes, as two of the sponsorship assets, one, the global individual image rights of Messi, and two, the global individual rights of Neymar. So by kind of any new kind of main shirt sponsor of Barcelona will automatically be contracting these agreements as well. So the question I have from that is, let's say a new shirt sponsor of Barcelona comes in, pays similar to what Chevrolet are paying Manchester United, so a lot of money. How does that then, the value that the rights of Messi and Neymar as part of that deal, how do they then get translated to the two players in that instance?
Ooh, good question. I suppose Barcelona must already have an agreement in place with Messi and Neymar as to how much they pay for those rights. An agreement in place with
Messi and with Doyen, presumably, who own Neymar's image rights. And that must then be factored into the amount they're looking for in terms of the overall sponsorship. So if they're going to pay those two $5 million a year and they wanted $40 million for the shirt sponsorship, then they'd be looking for $50 from a third party. I'd be interested to see exactly what rights the sponsor would get for Neymar and Messi, because obviously it wouldn't be in every context. You've already got boot deals and associations with Pepsi and Cole and EA Sports probably and things. So it'd be interesting to see exactly what rights they get. But I think that's just another, probably another signal of how developed the top clubs are becoming in terms of not just those club rights, the historic club rights, but also the player context rights, and how the clubs are seeing an opportunity to monetise those as well.
And sorry, just briefly, the other one that I saw that was quite interesting recently was United's deal with 21st Century Fox. So you may have noticed that when the Revenant came out, all Man United players suddenly all tweeted the same message, which was just watch The Revenant, great film, link to the trailer, which, you know, probably 3 or 4 years ago, you'd never see a sponsored deal constructed like that, because they'd have to individually contract with each player over their social media accounts. But I assume that's Man United have somehow set up the image rights so that they control a certain amount of the player's social media accounts, and can thereby offer sponsors a social media based partnership where it's actually, it seems to be individual endorsements, but it's driven through a club agreement.
Social media, I'll
hold on to you. Yeah, but you're exactly right in that what is likely to happen, I know obviously it's pretty common that United do that, is that that's where United will probably have had a number of arrangements whereby they would have been purchasing the club's, the players' individual endorsement rights as well as their club context rights. And in that way, that would just give them additional control over, again, like social media. But again, I mean, the interesting thing about that I found was that players need to be very careful about putting in their tweet that actually it is a commercial advertisement tweet, effectively. Wayne Rooney got into trouble with it a few years ago. Rio Ferdinand was potential issues with them to do with the advertising regulations. So that's one thing that I think as a separate point. But it's all just about being joined up and linked into being able to put a message out there which looks like it may be club, but actually that I think is probably individual based, but it's individual based on the agreements that they have with the club, if that isn't very confusing.
Thank you. My question is actually all going to pick up in a while ago, actually, but just to give people context, I used to work at a club and looking after this side of things. So I guess the point I'm making is one of the biggest challenges was the players themselves. So they might have all the paperwork done, they might have very organised commercial team on their own and agents who are kind of on the ball. But convincing them to do an extra appearance or an extra tweet or signing 20 extra shirts, it was often the biggest challenge. And they almost saw themselves as just one of the squad rather than a player who was maybe a greater endorsement deal than somebody else or an image rights deal than somebody else. So I guess my question is, firstly, it was an absolute pain in the neck. And my question is, are the punishments or the threat of HMRC coming after players real? Or like you said, is it, look, we know it's all kind of being done and they're making the best efforts, but the Premier League contract has a set number of hours per week, both for the commercial and foundation activity that, let's say, a normal player is expected to do. But an image rights player is expected to do twice as many, for example, or three times as many. And trust me, they don't come anywhere near either number. So is that threat real, that they will come after them and, you know, create extra tax bills, etc.?
Historically, it has been, and they're quite dogged about the inquiries. So if they get started, the question is whether they start an inquiry this day and age, rather than the old days of inquiring into everyone. Now it might be specific players, and if they've got a reason to start an inquiry, and it may even be that they're inquiring into something else, so they ask about image rights anyway. So they might be asking about agents' fees and benefits in kind, and they're just throwing image rights inquiry in there. But when they look into it, certainly we've got one at the moment up in Manchester where they've asked us to go back and get from the commercial department all the commercial appearances that the player's been involved in over the length of the contract and things. They will dig into it. I would hope that
from this new deal onwards, as long as, you know, the clubs are able to state player's name, image rights company, amount paid, and show three campaigns the player's been involved in, I'm sure HMRC will Google it. And, you know, as long as they can see the player's face in those three, they've done the minimum relevant activities, and they're happy with that. And hopefully that takes a lot of the risk out for the players. But as you say, even getting some of the players to do three can be hard work. So some of the clubs are better than others, I think. Some of the clubs kind of frog march them in and make sure they do it.
And just on that, I think some players are better than others.
Yes, yeah,
some are very educated about it and will actually come knocking saying, I should be doing an extra one, my tax bill is due, etc. But some will literally run out the back door, so it's not so they do it. So, you see both sides.
And also, just very briefly on the point where you're saying about the number of tweets or the number of hours, we've seen plenty of contracts where there will be a designated number of hours if they're in the UK, a designated number of hours if they're travelling outside of the UK, how much time that would actually take, how that would incorporate the number of appearances over a year if they were went over a certain amount of hours, particular times. I haven't quite seen a number of tweets time, but I don't think it's really surprising enough in a year or two's time to say, specifically for guys that have maybe social media or followings in the millions, for them to say we expect 10 tweets per quarter or something for these particular brands to control to ensure that they're getting the value that they need. That
exists in club sponsor contracts.
Exactly.
So, you know, X tweets, yeah. Or X Facebook posts. And
yeah.
It's
a logical extension.
Jonathan, the white jumper. We've probably got one more after you. We might get two. We'll see how quick the question is.
Thank you. I don't know if you can help with this, but it relates to tax and image rights in France and abroad. I was curious. I'm just curious to know how the image rights may have worked for David Beckham when he signed at PSG. I remember, whatever it was, 5, 6 years ago. I remember his salary went to charity, and so the assumption was always that there was a press assumption seemed to be that there was an enormous image rights deal. And so I wonder whether that was something that was way beyond the 20% that one might expect to see here. I'm curious to know a bit more about that.
Yeah, I think there was supposed to be a big image rights film. We don't look after David, unfortunately. I know who does, but we don't. His image rights, I think he had image rights companies in a couple of different territories, and I imagine what happened was PSG donated his salary to charity, it's probably a fairly nominal charity and salary, and they made a big commercial payment to his image rights companies outside of France, and there was no French social security. I'm not sure whether the French have those rules around 20% of, you know, that's pretty much an HMRC rule. Interestingly, in other countries, rules have developed quite differently, and certainly Italy now is not, generally image rights is not seen in a good light. Spain have had lots of wrangles around image rights, and where they've got to is that, yes, you can have an image rights company that can receive 20% of the overall package, but of that 20% in the company, 85% is assumed to be salary to the player, so actually it's reduced the benefit significantly. France, I'm not sure about. We haven't done too much in France, but like I said, I think my understanding was it was a chunky image rights payment, which they can probably justify being David and using him in various campaigns, and it was to companies outside of France. So that's how it worked.
We have two more people with their hands up. If you make your questions so tight and focused, we might get them both in. So.
Hi, Tom Gaynor. I work at Oxford with Dan as well, more on the activation side, and with a number of Premier League clubs, and it's been mentioned by a few people that getting players to do commercial activity can be a bit of a challenge. So I was wondering if you had a response to it. The sponsor has requested three players and the club have given an agreement that those three players will do that commercial activity, but then one of those players decides not to turn up, not because of an injury, but because they personally don't want to. Does the brand actually have any legal justifications to take that any further because of the effect that they might have on sales and their potential promotion?
So some of the endorsement deals and sponsorship deals that we've seen, which is a combination of different things. Sometimes a three strikes and you're out rule, which is we want these three players. If these three for a particular time, the first time one doesn't turn up, then that's a one strike. and the result of a three strike for whatever reason means a deduction of 10% of the gross revenue that the sponsor would provide to the club. It can be something, depending on the commercial negotiation position of the parties, it can simply be that that's just the luck of the draw and we'll try and get someone else for you. But usually, in my experience, the sponsor will want a particular type of player to fit the demographic, as you can well imagine. So a lot of the time what will sometimes happen is they will ask for sometimes a particular aged player in substitute, depending on the side agreement. The agreement could be like a side agreement saying if you can't get, let's just say Liverpool, it's Daniel Sturridge for England market, Coutinho for Brazilian market, and Henderson because he's in the English squad again. If they can't get Henderson, for example, they might say, right, well, we need Lallana, for example, because he fits the same type of profile. And if, for example, you can't get Coutinho, then we want Firmino, for example, let's just say. So what can sometimes happen is there can be a larger agreement which is more global in its type of wording, but then you can get into a forensic sub-agreement which says we want these guys, and if these guys can't come as stipulated in the contract, then we want this person, this person, this person. And if that doesn't happen, then those three strike type of things and discounts come into effect. If that isn't, sorry, too.
Yeah, I think termination provisions have got a lot tighter in the last few years as well. Brands are more aware of making sure that they've got the right to terminate in certain circumstances. I think that's probably post Tiger Woods, where most of the main Tiger brands had a felony clause, so if you committed a crime, they could terminate him. Didn't commit a crime, so most of them just gradually kind of dropped him down. Accenture had to pull that brilliant Unleash Your Hidden Tiger advert. That one had to go, unfortunately.
Okay, last question over there, please.
I'm Sean, that's also long in time. Thank you, Daniel. Okay. I actually advising the image rights contract case in China between foreign player and Chinese developer. You know, unlike salary disputes, the decision. Salary disputes, it can be enforced by the FIFA or national football associations.
Yeah.
But the image rights contract, it belongs to commercial rights. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it should, from my own point of view, it should be recognized and enforced by national. So I'm wondering what's your opinion about this issue. Lastly, it should be noted that in China there are not so many salary disputes.
Okay.
Not yet.
Yeah, so I just think, very briefly, usually all the contracts, the image rights contracts that we've seen, at least from the assignment, if the assignment is into a UK company, it will almost certainly, the jurisdiction clauses will be England and Wales courts. If it is for the particular contractual arrangement, if the club is contracting with, let's just say, a non-UK image rights company, there may be an argument that says wherever the image rights company is based, the jurisdiction clause is for where the IR company is based. But in my experience anyway, a lot of foreign jurisdictions and UK guys prefer Court of England and Wales, or in the alternative, some type of arbitration or mediation clause, because obviously High Court can get pretty pricey and expensive.
Okay. We've already run over into extra time. I'd like to thank you all for coming, first of all. Some great questions from the floor, and not just questions but observations. Thank you to the student helpers, you won't be forgotten. But more than anything else, I'd like to really thank Daniel, Jonny, Pete. I thought it was brilliant. It was really, really good. So thank you.